Tonight, police and fire officials report an incident-free carnival season. A campaign to raise $1 million for high jump star Laverne Spencer gets underway. Talk show host Rick Wayne blames the opposition SLP for the deplorable state of the George Odlum Stadium. And Groseillers MP Leonard Motute announces plans to boost economic activity in the constituency. Very good evening to you. Welcome to the Friday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polio. We commence the broadcast tonight with news that apart from a few minor scuffles, the police and the fire and emergency service are reporting a relatively smooth carnival celebration. The activity was held on July 16th and 17th. DBS's Alex Buske begins our news coverage.
National Security Minister Herman Guild Francis thanked the Royal St. Lucia Police Force and the Fire and Emergency Service for doing a good job at maintaining law and order during the carnival celebrations. He noted that although the police resources were stretched, they maintained a high presence at every activity. He also thanked the citizens for their good behavior.
I must commend the men and women of the police force for doing an excellent job. The fire service, although they may be in the background, but they also had to be at every show for fire and other hazards and emergencies and so on. And they too played a pivotal role in making the activities a success.
Police Commissioner Sevre Moncheri expressed similar sentiments. He commended his hardworking police officers for going above and beyond the call of duty. All told, 400 officers were deployed. The commissioner thanked the organizers for playing their part in keeping the celebrations orderly.
I must also thank and commend my hardworking police officers who acted professionally at all times and who really gave them their all during that season. We had some very long hours and they had to sacrifice a lot, and I must thank and commend them for that.
Acting Chief Fire Officer Joseph Joseph reported 55 carnival-related emergency calls. This included 4 stabbing incidents and reports involving drunkenness and severe dehydration.
They had to put in, quite a few long hours. So I must extend my appreciation for their hard work, and I ask them to keep up the good work.
The fire service is looking to increase its manpower. 45 persons will be trained to join the department. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
Consultant Frank Myers is attempting to raise $1 million for St. Lucia's high jump star Laverne Spencer. Spencer won the gold at the April 2018 Commonwealth Games in Australia, but Myers feels not enough was done to recognize the achievement. Don Nicholas has the details.
Consultant Frank Myers feels that St. Lucia's high jump star Laverne Spencer needs to be adequately rewarded for her performances at various world championships. He was not happy with the National Olympic Committee for presenting what it called a token of $10,000 to Ms. Spencer for capturing a gold award at the Commonwealth Games in Australia. He says the committee could have done much better. This has prompted Mr. Myers to embark on a $1 million fundraising drive. He hopes to raise the money by year end.
The president said effectively that the committee was giving Laverne a token for her achievements in Australia. I had a problem with the use of the word token, simply because that the magnitude of Laverne's performances culminating in that particular one over the years should not be reduced to being recognized by a token.
Mr. Myers also took issue with plans to honor Ms. Spencer at St. Lucia's 40th independence anniversary. He believes that a special ceremony in her honor ought to be convened immediately, but he says this is typical of the way things are done here.
This is unacceptable, and it's sort of symptomatic of the way we deal with things in our country, where we put things off until they're almost irrelevant. I believe she should have been, her efforts should have been immediately, her achievements rather, should have been immediately recognized by some appropriate reward for them.
Mr. Myers revealed that initially he was guilty of underestimating Ms. Spencer's ability, thinking that she would never be able to compete again at international level. But seeing her last performance, he was forced to change his mind. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
In other news, ahead of the 56th meeting of the presiding officers of the Regional Conference of Women in Latin America and the Caribbean, to be held in Santiago, Chile from July 30th to July 31st, 2018, the Ministry of Education, Innovation, Gender Relations and Sustainable Development is hosting a consultation on the topic, Women's Autonomy in Changing Economic Scenarios, with specific emphasis on the St. Lucian context. The high-level event is expected to explore the opinions of key stakeholders on issues relating to equality and women's autonomy. Participants are expected to discuss women's autonomy in the current economic context as it relates to economic growth, the rate of employment, the quality of employment, and the gender gaps that exist in that regard. Examine the economic policies that hinder or enhance women's employability and autonomy in St. Lucia, and explore how international agreements such as the Montevideo Strategy contribute to the achievement of the Sustainable Development Goals. The Montevideo Strategy, which will be a central focus of the consultation, serves as a roadmap to guide the implementation of the regional gender agenda and ensure that countries are well poised to achieve the 2030 agenda for sustainable development at the regional level from the perspective of gender equality, women's autonomy, and human rights. The event is expected to attract men and women from regional agencies, academia, politics, business, the media, and civil society, and is scheduled for next Thursday at the Auberge Serafin Conference Room. The St. Lucia Hotel and Tourism Association held its much-anticipated Linkages in Tourism Trade Show today. The activity targeted individuals and companies looking to build networks and create new business opportunities. Alex Buske reports.
The aim, according to the Linkages officer at the SLHTA, is to replicate the success enjoyed by the farmers in recent times in other industries.
The main aim of this trade show is to show inclusion within the sectors, the hospitality sector, manufacturing sector, agro-processing sector. We're trying to link and to allow everybody to enjoy the tourism dollar, to benefit from it.
Business Development Officer within the Department of Commerce, Jonathan Allen, says the initiative allows clients of the Small Enterprise Development Unit to present their goods and services with the hope of them being picked up by the hotels.
We believe that it's a great initiative because we have been involved with it for the past 4 years. And we have had success stories of some of our clients being able to sell some of their stuff to the hotels, which is a great opportunity.
The representative of Island Mix Products says he can foresee this trade show opening doors for small business people who possess excellent products.
So quite a few well-known local artists are represented here at Island Mix. And we also look at people who are artisans, who make things with their hands, where you have handmade jewelry, you have t-shirts, you have all kinds of things that we can, that are great linkages to the tourism industry, because these artists can produce materials for the tourism industry. We can put things in hotel rooms, we can put them as ornaments around the public areas. So there's quite a few things that we do and provide for the tourism industry.
Mr. Ale is hoping that there will be more activities of this nature in the near future. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Busquet, and you're watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes. What makes Saturday and Sunday the strongest days?
I think these 2 days are so strong because this is the time that most of our people have the time for themselves. If you are a working man or working woman, you work from Monday to Friday full time. There you are concentrating positively and directly on the work that you do. Very little time for yourself. And there comes Saturday and Sunday. 2 days you don't have to work for the boss man. You got to see about self now. This time you are selfish. You look at yourself, you clean yourself, and that is it. And that is what makes it strong. Saturdays and Sundays.
What makes Saturday and Sunday the strongest day in the week? Because Saturday is Sabbath. Sunday is the day of a man to rest. Sunny day, you know what I'm telling you? Monday is Monday for men. Wednesday is for women. But Saturday is a special day. Well, Saturday you could have to just consider the Almighty Sabbath, God. Let me cool out, do something, all right?
Saturday and Sunday. Well, if I tell you honestly, I don't know. I know because both Saturday and Sunday is more or less a religious days. You have the Seventh-day Adventist faith and then you have the Catholic faith on a Sunday, which makes those 2 days kind of paramount, you know, just because of the affiliation with the
Christian.
Yeah, the Christian faith, the religion, the religious, you know. That's what makes it strong.
That's when people have the most stress and the most worrying around and the most home stress. Because everything has changed around. Like from the years to the dates to the month. Because before, the first month of the year was March. Then change calendar. But the stress of Saturday and Sunday, releasing from work, taking health care, running groceries, paying bills. So when Saturday finish, Sunday is more stressed out, so when Monday come, you out.
Well, I guess Saturday for me, it kind of holy. Yeah, because for me, that's the day I really worship. And Sunday, it's still a worship day, but I guess it's for pagans.
What makes Saturday and Sunday the strongest days? Because all the rest are just weekdays. Weekdays. All the rest are weekdays. You've just been watching Friday Funnies with me, Alex Busquet, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Street. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online and the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, the former SLP government blamed for the deplorable state of the George Odlam Stadium, and the Grozile MP outlines plans to boost economic activity in the area. Welcome back and thank you so much for staying with us. Former Health Minister Alvina Reynolds has been heavily criticized by talk show host Rick Wayne for a report in which she absolved herself and her ministry from the responsibility of repairing the George Odlam Stadium. Mr. Wayne made the comments on Thursday during his program. Don Nicholas has more.
The hazard to health.
Talk show host Rick Wayne played a DBS News report where then Health Minister Alvina Reynolds said that it was not her ministry's responsibility to repair the George Odlam Stadium. At the time, the minister said there were a few setbacks but indicated that her ministry was working feverishly to vacate the stadium as soon as possible.
It cost a lot of money that the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports may not have at this time, and the Ministry of Health doesn't have either, because of course it's not the Ministry of Health's responsibility to repair the stadium.
The former health minister acknowledged the contribution that Seablast and other elements made to the deterioration of the stadium. However, Mr. Wayne noted that as far back as 2014, the government of the day knew very well that the situation at the makeshift facility was deadly. He claims to have reports and letters written to health officials back then relating the horrific conditions under which patients were being housed there. Ironically, according to him, Ms. Reynolds and other members of the opposition are now putting pressure on the UWP administration to rectify the situation.
The hazard to health, to life hazards, as far as the workers, the nurses, doctors, etc. are concerned, and not a word from the ministers involved. In fact, one is telling you it's not her business.
The current government has undertaken repairs to the George Odlam Stadium, but has been asked to stop the works over concerns about the health implications for staff and patients. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Grozdale MP Leonard Montout says work has begun on a plan to boost economic activity in the constituency. Speaking at the launch of the Mercury Fest Beach Party this week, the MP explained that a calendar of activities was being planned that would see the hosting of a series of mass crowd events that would also capitalize on the presence of several hotels in the constituency. We hear more in this report.
The world-renowned Grozdale Street Party will kick off the rebranded Mercury Fest in August. The event, which takes place at the Pigeon Island National Landmark, is expected to pick up where the original Mercury Beach Party left off and attract thousands of foreign nationals and generate hundreds of thousands of dollars in revenue. But Grozdale MP Leonard Montout wants his community to move from just hosting such events to becoming an active partner, one that can benefit more directly.
We are looking in Grozdale not just to be host, not just to be facilitators, but to be partners. Because for a while we have been observers and spectators and not beneficiaries of what is going on within the constituency of Grozdale.
The minister has welcomed the news that vendors will be allowed to set up shop during the new Mercury Fest event. This was not the case under the former management. He is hopeful that moving forward, the Constituency Council can work more closely with the St. Lucia Tourism Authority and the Events Company of St. Lucia to organize events that can maximize the profits and benefits to Grozdale.
From events like cricket and other, you know, shows that take place. So I hear a lot of after parties going on during Carnival, but then, you know, I ask myself, you know, where is the after sessions for cricket and for other big events that take place within this constituency that is taking place on the streets of Grozdale.
The MP is also hoping to see more government investment in the popular Grozdale Friday night street party, which is as popular among tourists as it is among locals. Several changes have been planned for the event. This will include improved lighting and security after several violent confrontations threatened to end the decades-old event.
Even the architecture of Grozdale we have been discussing. The mayor and I have, you know, sat many times and discussed what we want. We have discussed with Ministry of Planning and the Prime Minister. Grozdale is earmarked as one of the communities that will benefit from village tourism this year, along with Ancillary and Soufre. And of course, we being really the mecca for tourism, unlike what people in Soufre say, we want to ensure that we provide a product that will not just be for entertainment, but in terms of the cultural, geographic, and, you know, heritage significance, we want to be able to provide an experience that is memorable and that will lure our visitors to return, not just to St. Lucia, but to Grozdale.
He expressed the hope that the upcoming Mercury Fest will become a permanent part of the planned calendar of activities for Grozdale. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
The Castries Constituency's Council is getting set to host a Night of the Monarchs, an event featuring winners of the Calypso competition over the years. The event will be held between the Vendors Arcade and the Castries Craft.
The event starts from 7 p.m. and of course it is one to kick off, you know, our usual city night, which is every Saturday, held every Saturday evening, and also to sort of, you know, revive the city and bring some level of relief to our vendors which ply the trade in the city of Castries.
Organizers have collaborated with the Steel Pan Association to put on a steel pan display on the evening.
We've also collaborated with our Calypso associations, where we'll be featuring our Calypso King. We will be featuring our Junior Calypso King as well. We'll also be featuring King and Queen of the Bands, and there are many other side attractions. So persons could come and support the event. It's a free event, and it starts from 7 p.m.
Mr. Hullingseed says the council is looking forward to making this an annual event to bring the curtains down on the carnival celebrations. Eight-time Calypso monarch Desmond Long, otherwise known as the Mighty Pep, has come out in support of calls for the judging criteria for Calypso to be reviewed.
I don't agree that it has outlived its purpose.
if anyone takes the criteria for judging the calypsos, they will see it's fairly thorough and gives a proper guide to the judges as to what to look for in the song. A lot of it is, for example, when you look at the lyrics, how you construct your lyrics, what they're looking for in terms of play on words, metaphors, you know, alliterations, all these things that you score points on. So it's well guided as to how the judges should score the points. Every year you may find one or two little things happening, and like any set of rules and regulations, or whether it's a constitution or what you're dealing with, there is always need to modify it from time to time.
Using the case of the blacks, he says there's nothing in the regulations preventing them from singing together, but the judges will still be guided by the same criteria used to judge a single performer.
So what they'll need to just tweak the rules so as to see how do they handle. So I wouldn't say it's outlived itself. I mean, if you go through it, it's very comprehensive, and I think it's one of the best that we've had for years. It has held on for years. It compares exactly to, almost similar to what Trinidad has in the as part of the criteria. And so it is the way it is written and what you're looking for to score and the Calypsoans, I think it is well done. But like I said, it has to be tweaked from time to time to meet up with what's happening. Remember, we had a situation sometime back with the age limit for Calypso, and when it was not written in stone that you had to be a certain age, and younger persons kept coming in, so that had to be modified to allow that to happen. So that's what needs to happen.
Long says as things change in the Calypso arena, the rules and regulations will have to be adjusted. Young persons interested in film careers get training. We'll tell you more in just a bit. Organizers of the Caribbean Youth Film Festival are about to begin their summer workshops for young persons interested in film production. Participants also have the opportunity to win a variety of prizes at the end of the exercise. Here is Don Nicholas with the detail.
Organizers of the Caribbean Youth Film Festival will be conducting a series of workshops around the island aimed at equipping young filmmakers with skills ranging from basic technical training to life skills. Coordinators are working with the St. Lucia Hotel and Tourism Association, SLHTA, on the project. The workshops run from August 6th to 17th and culminates in an award ceremony on August 18th. In the past, the training has been instrumental in enabling young persons to pursue careers in filmmaking.
We have seen, you know, a number of persons who have actually graduated from that process. We have a number of guys who are actually doing filmmaking as a career and as a degree in filmmaking in the various universities.
Mr. Weeks noted an increase in the number of youngsters indicating their interest. Last year, over 300 young ones participated in the program, which caters for persons between the ages of 10 to 35. The deadline for participants to submit their work is August 14th.
Our awards are the first prize, second prize. We have best director, best screenplay, best actor, best actress. And I must say that it's become a true Caribbean festival where we have had participation from St. Vincent, Grenada, Guadeloupe, Jamaica, Barbados, and exactly what it is. It's become a true Caribbean film festival.
Mr. Weeks thanked the sponsors for their continued support. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
In other news, Massey Stores today made a presentation of school supplies. The donation took place at Massey Mega J. Don Nicholas reports.
Massey Stores Limited recognized the contribution that school summer camps are making to the holistic development of students. While parents are preoccupied with summer, they're also concerned about back-to-school expenses. Friday's presentation was coined Make Summer Fun and Back to School Easier. One of the recipients, Crayons for Classrooms, was set up to help underprivileged students at the Mondidor Primary School. This year, it extended its commitment to include the Blusher Combined School. Altogether, 400 students are expected to benefit.
We want to recognize our camps that are here with us because our camps really do make a difference for parents during the summertime. The other side of this equation is that while parents are concerned with summer, they're also thinking about back to school and the expenses associated with getting the books and all the stationery and the supplies and the uniforms. And so the two organizations that are here with us, they both perhaps in a very meaningful way help parents when it comes to these two issues.
The Grosile Football League also received school supplies. Both organizations expressed their gratitude.
We just want to say a very big thank you to Massey for partnering with us again, for joining us. It's really an honor and a pleasure to be back here to accept a donation today.
Speaking on behalf of the Grosile Football League, I would say that the camp ensures that participants not only focus on technical skills, but in the morning, For the duration of 2 weeks, we do live skills.
The presentation took place at Massey Mega J. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues. Time now for the usual reminder. Police and fire officials report an incident-free carnival season. A campaign to raise $1 million for high jump star Laverne Spencer gets underway. Talk show host Rick Wayne blames the opposition SLP for the deplorable state of the George Odlam Stadium. And Grosile MP Leonard Motute announces plans to boost economic activity in the constituency. That's the broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polian, wishing you a very good evening and a pleasant weekend. Good night and see you next time.